You've had quite a big day. You started out first thing this morning breaking news with my colleague Ed Ludlow about a funding round that doubles your valuation to $30.5 billion post-money. I want to have you elaborate a little bit on why did you need $2.5 billion and specifically how much of this is on Arsenal One, for example, this big mega factory that you've started in Ohio. You also talked about growth in the team. So where does that go?
Yeah, I mean, we're in an interesting position as a defense products company. You know, rather than the traditional kind of last 50 years of the defense model, which is predicated on cost plus contracting, where the government pays you to develop something, and then they pay you to buy that thing, and then they pay you to maintain and support that thing over, in many cases, 50 to 100 years. And then you just take a margin on top of that. We're actually...
You're doing it yourself.
We're doing it ourselves, right. So we're taking on the cost of development, we're taking on the cost of production, and then we're selling a product, a completed product to the government. And because of that, it means that, you know, this is a capital-intensive business, and if we're going to operate at a speed and a scale that's relevant to the warfighter, as we're seeing from, you know, theaters like Ukraine and Israel, things move very quickly, and we need to move at a speed of relevance. In order to do that, we need to be able to deploy our own capital into those problem sets. So, you know, north of $1 billion of that is just purely reserved for scaling production, which not only involves the Arsenal site in Ohio, but also building out shipyards for our undersea systems, and you know, additional prototype manufacturing sites and test sites and things like that. So there's a lot of moving pieces.
And then 1.5 additionally on growth initiatives, people. Do you, you know, can you talk a little bit about what your ambitions are in terms of growing the team?
Yeah, so Anduril is not a single product company. You know, we're not like, you know, an enterprise software company that has like one core thing that it represents the power law distribution of revenue to the business. We operate with a bunch of different business lines. We build autonomous systems in every domain, everything from, you know, undersea systems all the way into space and everything in between. And because of that, we're constantly launching new products that we're selling into our customer set. And so a lot of that capital will go into continuing to keep our pedal to the metal on product development, which is both headcount as well as, you know, the cost of developing hardware is not just headcount, it's everything that goes into that, facilities and things like that. So pretty broad ranging.
You have talked about ambitions for more, like Arsenal One is just the beginning, if you will, of mega factories. More across the country is what you and your colleagues have told us. Can you elaborate on that? Can you tell us a little bit more about kind of where might we look geographically, and how many more are you envisioning at this point?
Yeah, I mean, there's a reason we called it Arsenal One, because there will be an Arsenal Two and an Arsenal Three. I think this takes a couple of different shapes. First is domestically, I think we'll continue building out our manufacturing capabilities. We're starting with about 800,000 square feet in Ohio. That's the first building on the campus. That will expand to 5 million square feet over the coming years. But we'll also be building out facilities to do things like solid rocket motor production, which we already have a facility that's been stood up to do that. Shipyards, as I said. Yep. So there will be big opportunities to scale into Arsenal 2, Arsenal 3, and so forth. In addition to that, there's also a really interesting angle with international, where working with our allies and partners, we could stand up manufacturing capacity in those countries as well, which, as you might imagine, from the perspective of a national prosperity agenda, these are really important signals of partnership to our closest friends abroad. So I think that will be part of the Arsenal strategy as well, is to build out that manufacturing capacity in places like the UK or, you know, other places like that.
Great. As I understand it, your first products from Arsenal One will be manufactured July 2026. Are you still holding to that timetable?
I think we are. It's not just our timetable. It's the timetable of the United States government. So, yes, that is the timetable, God willing.
Speaking of the U.S. government, we've started to get signs from the Trump administration on, you know, its plans for modernizing the military. And that's something that, they consulted with you on. Can you give us a sense right now on what you see them doing that gives you hope, and what are things that the Defense Department is doing that you think they should be doing more quickly or differently?
You know, this kind of attention that's been paid to next generation capabilities started all the way back really with the Ash Carter secretaryship under the Barack Obama administration. He's the guy that set up the Defense Innovation Unit, the Defense Innovation Board, the Defense Digital Service, the Third Offset Initiative. He really had this vision that conflict was changing. We weren't going to be living in this world of kind of non-nation-state conflict, counterinsurgency, counterterrorism, but we were moving into nation-state conflict and needed to handle things very differently as a result. You know, there's kind of been fits and starts since Ash about how things have morphed and how seriously the department has taken it. But I think we're at a place now where the civilian leadership of the agencies as well as the political leadership of the agencies are aligned behind the idea that we really have to move quickly into these new capability sets. So, you know, obviously it's still very early in the Trump administration, but I think they have a great set of leaders in the department, and they're directing the budget to the right places. If you go back to earlier this year where they talked about doing the budget cut to the DoD top line, and they listed the exception programs, I think there were 17 of them, really all of them were these next generation capabilities. So there's clear alignment here.
Moving too slow in any areas, moving in the wrong direction in your view thus far?
I think it's really hard to say. Obviously, like, the most important thing is to move past volatility into action. Mm-hmm. And, you know, they understand the target that's been set in front of them. And I believe at least they're motivated appropriately to do the right thing.
Let's talk about nation state threats. The U.S. is engaged in a very robust effort to hamstring the Chinese and their access to advanced technologies, chips, et cetera, artificial intelligence. Do you think that what you've seen so far, and this is not just about Trump, this is about policies that were pursued under his predecessor and then him in his first administration, are we going about, if you believe that we really do need to hamstring China's ability and its access to advanced technology, are we going about that in the right way?
I mean, there's so many different layers to how this plays together. It's not just, for example, like blocking access to cutting edge semiconductors. It goes as deep as materials, natural resources. Obviously, China has run a very effective strategy for a long time now with the Belt and Road Initiative to make sure that they're securing access to critical materials and minerals that that we need to take this next step. So we have a really complex kind of strategic response that will be required to do a good job of this. You know, they're going to be, they will approach these problem sets very differently than we will as a result of where their advantages lie. I don't expect that there's going to be a tremendous amount of, you know, innovation and really cutting edge capabilities. I think it will be more like fast following working on incremental improvements to existing capabilities to give them, you know, more range, better sensing, things like that, to give them an advantage on the battlefield. And so a lot of this will come down to how quickly we can move. And that has not been a strength of the U.S. Department of Defense for the last 50 years.
You mean how quickly we can move in staying ahead and deploying the technologies that we have access to?
Yeah, if you think about it, more time has passed between the first flight of the SR-71 to today then passed between the Wright Flyer to the SR-71. That's crazy. We used to move really fast, and then we kind of lost that muscle. Yeah. In fact, if you look at the capabilities that we've been sending over to Ukraine, for example, almost everything we're sending them were Cold War era technologies that have been sitting in warehouses. I think the average American believes that there's all this like nearly extraterrestrial technology sitting in classified bunkers all over the country, and we have this impenetrable advantage against our adversaries, and it's just not true.
But the Ukrainians have been, to their credit, pretty innovative and done a lot with what they have, and obviously a lot of help from the U.S. and its allies, but they've been pretty innovative.
They have been very innovative. They've been innovative with using existing technologies deployed in creative ways. And I think this is always what happens in conflict. You know, if you show up to a conflict with 50-year-old technology, you're very unlikely to win that war against a great power.
Right.
But if you have the ability to iterate very quickly using those technologies, you can pull off some pretty incredible feats. There was nothing particularly high tech, for example, over the weekend about what they did with the FPV drones. I mean, they just launched them out of a container sitting on the back of a truck. They had used Russian cellular networks to fly them. They had traditional kinetic payloads that were deployed on them. There was nothing super high tech about that. It was just, you know, the way it was deployed that was novel.
Before we get too far from China, I do want to ask about a subject that my team writes a lot about, and that is chips. And specifically, there is a criticism, I'll say it, Jensen Huang, he has a very vested interest in selling chips into China. But his argument is that the more we starve China of chips, particularly really advanced chips for AI, the faster we spur innovation in that country. Do you buy that argument? Are you in any way sympathetic to that?
There's definitely truth to this. I mean, they've done a really good job of building capabilities that we've prevented them from getting access to, or at least made difficult for them to get access to. You know, the real linchpin in this, though, is that if you want to do high-end semiconductors today in 2025, you need machines from ASML. And, you know, there's some amount of control that we have on the market to prevent access to things like the lithography machines. And so, you know, we both need to do the work on our end to shore up our own access and supply and to work on next generation capabilities that will get us out of that geopolitical tangle, while also making sure that we're not incentivizing the Chinese to run off and be able to beat us in those categories at the same time.
And as you said before, maybe develop some of our own technologies that we're maybe reliant on the ASML.
Totally, yeah. I mean, we've been, you know, pretty lazy, I would argue, on semiconductors because we've had this very convenient, you know, option to just lay back on TSMC's capabilities, but that's certainly not guaranteed. Obviously, Xi has been talking about taking care of the Taiwan problem by 2027. That doesn't give us very long to figure out how to do that manufacturing domestically. And it's not something you can just snap your fingers and do. We can't just invest a ton of money and suddenly have a high-end, you know, high-production, high-yield semiconductor fab in the United States. It doesn't work like that.
Yep.
So we need to be figuring out ways that we can invest in every layer of that infrastructure to be able to have a domestic ability that we frankly don't have right now.
Last couple of years, we've seen an abundance of investing and interest in military technology, innovative military technology. Your company, a lot of other companies, is there going to be enough demand for these emerging technologies, especially given the entrenched position of the primes, to justify this amount of investment that we're seeing?
The challenge with category investing of any type, whether it's, you know, social media or space or crypto, is that usually there is sort of a monopoly concentration to the winner. If you were a social media investor and you didn't invest in Facebook, you probably lost money. If you were a space investor and you didn't invest in SpaceX, you probably lost money. If you're a crypto investor, you didn't invest in Coinbase, you probably lost money. So there's a bit of a lie behind this idea that, like, a market can get hot. Yeah. That's not really how, like, the creation of generational companies happens. That said, I do think that there's more than just Anduril scale opportunities. Obviously, I think we have a really dominant market position right now with defense products, with defense tech, but that doesn't mean that there won't be any others. I do believe that it won't be 20 others. I mean, keep in mind, there are only like 5 or 6 large scale primes that exist in the world today. In addition to that, the US government has kind of an obligation in many ways to ensure that their top providers don't have economic problems because they're on the hook to sustain these programs that they've spent, in many cases, trillions of dollars on to prevent those from going into total disarray. You could argue, in fact, in some ways that, you know, the next generation air dominance, the sixth generation manned fighter jet, Boeing got a $20 billion design contract. There's always a question of, did they get that design contract because they're actually going to follow through with building a sixth-generation manned fighter plane, or did they get it as a TARP funding to prevent them from going under, given all of the very public problems that the company has had in recent years?
I want to get to Founders Fund. Before we do, very quickly, in September, you announced that Anduril had deployed 300 autonomous surveillance towers, ASTs, in support of customs and border protection. Can you update us where that number is now, if you were to put out a press release?
Yeah, no, I think the right framing on this is probably less about the number of towers and more about total coverage. Yeah. We're deployed across somewhere between a third and half of the entire Southwest border at this point. Yeah. There tends to be this belief that border security is this super partisan topic. It's actually not. Most of the growth for Anduril in our work was under the Biden administration. Everyone agrees that you need to know what's coming across in both directions. And what we're able to do using the autonomous surveillance technology is give the our Border Patrol officers superhuman powers so that they can see things that they wouldn't be able to see otherwise. And they can make their own decisions about, how to handle apprehensions, how to handle pass-throughs.
Right.
And it's up to the Congress, obviously, to decide what the policy is for right. what you do with that data. But we're on the data providing side.
What do you make of the argument from critics that, look, it's a backhanded compliment. Your technology is so good that it is forcing migrants to pursue ever more dangerous, more remote, more life-threatening paths across the border. And whatever your politics, whatever your view on whether people should or shouldn't be coming across, there are people who genuinely fleeing violence or believe they have a legitimate reason to seek asylum or seek refuge in the U.S.
Totally. These are super complex moral questions because there's also been numerous times where ASTs have saved people's lives, where they've had a humanitarian crisis in the process of crossing the border, and had we not seen them in that moment, the Border Patrol folks would never have been able to get to them to address those crises as they were happening. So there's tension on both sides. The argument that we should know nothing because it creates a complicated moral situation, I think is also a moral decision that is going to result in the loss of human life. So. These things are really complicated. Obviously, we take that very seriously at Anduril. I'm never one to shy away from a complicated moral discussion.
Oh, well, we'll come back to that another time. I do quickly want to hear Founders Fund. You raised a $4.6 billion growth fund. Can you give us a sense of the areas where you want to see Founders Fund deploying that?
Well, the tricky thing to the point about category investing is that if you're focused on investing in categories, you're probably doing it wrong. You want to catch things before they become categories. And so really hard to say what it is that we're looking for. It's probably much easier to say what we're not looking for, which is we don't want to be dumping a bunch of concentrated capital into highly competitive industries. That's not a thing that we do. We're called Founders Fund for a reason. We invest in founder-led companies, so we're not going to be chasing a bunch of professional CEOs running very old businesses. But aside from that, we have very few dogma. We're very open to just being blown away by a business or a group of founders or, a combination of both.
You made an early bet on OpenAI. What is your larger thesis around artificial intelligence, and is it to continue to put eggs in that basket?
Well, I certainly think that AI is going to it's a paradigm shift in the way that we think about technology development in 2025 and beyond. No doubt about that at all. At the same time, it's a really competitive category. And so in some ways, it's looking back at the boom around COVID, we've almost learned none of the lessons, which is that if you run away with prices, things get incredibly out over their skis. People raise these mega rounds. You end up back in a place where people are doing down rounds and recaps and having difficulty fundraising. And so we're not going to create some sort of AI thesis and then chase investing in every single thing that fits that thesis at really, really high prices. I think that is a trap, and it's a trap that we should have learned our lessons from in prior cycles. And most VCs, for whatever reason, did not learn that lesson.